Welcome, welcome to the video. We're calling this the alchemy of ascension. There are these steps that are occurring to me as I wake up in the morning, and I sort of pray, say, I need the next step, and then suddenly, there coalesces in my mind a very clear declaration that I use then during the day, and it's actually very amazing and miraculous what is happening. Today, what occurred to me was to say, the location of this spaciousness doesn't matter. This spaciousness as it is now. Okay? The location of this spaciousness doesn't matter. This spaciousness as it is now. The location of this spaciousness doesn't matter. This spaciousness as it is now. And so I spent the whole day working on this, like a sort of like a composer or a pianist, you know, trying to get the right words in the right place. I put a lot of effort into to seeing what is the smooth way. When I woke up in the morning, I got this realization that location doesn't matter at all. The location of anything doesn't matter. And as a matter of fact, subconsciously, we're aware of all these locations and trying to control. We think that we need to manipulate and control everything. And that just puts an enormous burden on us. But when we realize that from the standpoint of now, which is zero dimensionality, the ground of being, pure everywhereness, pure spaciousness of God, that is God, everything is already abiding in that perfectly, just as it is. So this is a tremendously powerful declaration, actually. Spent the whole day on it. And so I would say the best form that I came up with is to say, and we'll use, for instance, a table. Or we can use this sofa. It's not really a sofa, is it? This lounge seat, this seat, this chair, what do you call this? I don't know. Well, maybe we won't use that. This background, we'll say, the location of this background spaciousness doesn't matter. This background spaciousness as it is now. This background spaciousness as it is now. This background spaciousness is now. And you can start out by saying something like, this computer is now. This computer is now. This computer is now. The location of this computer spaciousness doesn't matter. This computer spaciousness is now. You're looking at a wall, your room, okay, your room. The location of this room spaciousness doesn't matter. The location of this room spaciousness doesn't matter. This room spaciousness, as it is now. Okay, that's the form that came up today. Tremendous, but it took a lot of familiarity with the previous steps to be able to work with this and get it into a conceptual, concrete format like this where it can be really applied. I tried so many different ways and subtle different, you know, subtle changes, etc. And you can do variations off, but you can start out by saying, you know, this air we're breathing, the location, this air is now. This air is now. The location of this air spaciousness is now. Remember, we always use spaciousness in referring to anything. We have this terrible habit of referring to things, and that blinds us. That blinds us. It's really thing spaciousness. Everything is spaciousness, is a decoration in spaciousness. We can't tend to think that spaciousness stops where a thing starts. It's not true. It's not true. Everything is really intrinsic spaciousness, intrinsic emptiness. So this room, this air spaciousness is now. This air spaciousness is now. This air spaciousness as it is now. Then you go, the location of this air spaciousness doesn't matter. This air spaciousness as it is now. And so in being a guinea pig, I'm testing out these declarations and affirmations first before I give them out, just to make sure that they're okay. And I have experienced tremendous traction with what I'm giving out, and this one again is no exception. It's just amazing. I'm driving along, I say, the location of this rock spaciousness doesn't matter. This rock spaciousness as it is now. So I'm looking down like at the, I was looking down at a driveway full of pavers, and I saw this one paver stone sitting there, and I addressed it directly. I said, the location of this paver stone spaciousness doesn't matter. This paver stone spaciousness as it is now. And I felt this like, what happens is you start feeling this tremendous compassion and kinship with everything, because you realize location doesn't matter at all. And what is location? Location is always relative to other location. It's a totally relativistic concept, isn't it? Totally. So you could say the relative location of this paver stone spaciousness doesn't matter. You know, the fact that it is in a location relative to other pavers, in a driveway relative to other driveways, you know, in relative to the ground, relative to the air, it's in a specific location. But what we're doing is we're saying location doesn't matter at all to God. The location of this world spaciousness doesn't matter. This world spaciousness as it is now. These are very powerful practices. Now, shifting the emphasis a little bit here, we'll talk about practice in general, because my own history and experience is that virtually nobody practices. Teachers all know that, right? Teachers all know that. Everybody tries to find some way to fake it. Some are parrots, you know. They say, oh, I'm parroting it. I'm a good parrot and I can say it. And others say, ah, I don't, I'm smart enough. I don't need that. I can get it. I can figure it out. And others just don't do it. I got a feeling Jesus probably was fed up with me and dumped me. He said, this guy is never going to practice. What a waste of time. You know, it's a waste of talent. I have not had an inner experience of Jesus for like 20 years. And I think maybe he just dumped me, because I wouldn't practice. I said, no, I can figure this out. we're all that way. I tell you this, those who actually practice are really super advanced, because the resistance to practicing is incredible. I spent my whole life not practicing. I said, no, I'll get it. I can get it. I'll figure it out. You could be Albert Einstein times 10, and if you don't practice, you're not going to get it, for sure. There's no other way to get it other than practicing. Because what you're getting is you are actually healing your perception. You are shifting. You are putting the mind in the right, you're telling the mind, you're telling yourself. It is a totally different thing than some intellectual exercise. You actually get traction. Intellectually, you're just spinning. You're spinning your wheels in sand. No traction. Once you start practicing, you're in the club. It's kind of like, sometimes I look at these golfers, and there's some like professional golfers, and they come up to the ball, and they're looking at the shot. They look at it all different ways, and they're thinking, talking to the caddy for like 5 minutes. You know, what do they think? The wind, the yardage, the hill thing. How am I hitting my iron? Blah 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 blah. And then they get over the ball, and they start wiggling and they waggling. You know, they do a little waggle, little another one, and they back off and they look again. I don't like that club. Let me get another club. They get another club. What about this one? And they wiggle, and then they stop the wind. They throw up some grass. You know, how's the wind? Oh, the wind shifted. Let me wait a little bit, huh? Let me talk to the caddy some more. Get up there, waggle, 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 waggle. Freeze up and then sort of back off again, back off, you know. And imagine if you had a golfer doing that. They never swung the club. They're just waggling the club and talking to their caddy. Well, we're like that on the spiritual path, actually. We do a lot of talking to our caddy. And we're figuring out the shot, right? We're figuring out the shot. And And so we spend like a lifetime talking to the caddy. And we got it now. I think it's about 133 to the front. And we want to hit it about 138 and then take one bounce. It should be roll about 4 yards, 142 to the flag. But then we got a little crosswind. The winds are shifting. It's getting kind of late in the day. The atmosphere's a little heavy. I think the greens are a little wet. The ball's probably going to stick a little bit. I don't want it to spin too much. So I got to take a deal off a little bit, take a little spin off it. Maybe I'll hit a little three-quarter shot in there. Maybe I need to cut it a little bit. Wait a minute. The atmosphere's changing a little bit. You know, I'm feeling a little some twinge here. I'm not certain about my shot. Maybe I need to, you know, just hit and play with the middle of the green, blah, 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 blah. And you're talking to your caddy, and your caddy's, you know, talking back and saying, yeah, it's a good talk, good conversation. The ego's like your caddy. You know, the ego is giving you all this stuff, information like, well, maybe you need to hit this. And wait a minute, let's switch shift clubs. How do you feel about that one? You're not so confident? Well, I better not hit it then, okay. And you spend your whole life talking to the caddy. You never swing the club. Now, practicing is like you actually swing the club and you hit the ball. And you say, whoa, I hit the ball. Look at the ball's flying up there. It's like, oh my gosh, it's on the fringe of the green. I actually hit a pretty good shot. And you just say, wait, whoa, what happened? I hit the ball. It's exactly like that. You know, you're on the tee and you actually swing and hit the ball. And then you see the ball fly and you say, wow, I'm not so bad. Really, I was really worried. The ball would go nowhere, but actually it flew really well. So I was worried, like, if I start practicing this, you know, nothing will happen. You know, it's like, but no, just the opposite. I actually started realizing tremendous traction is happening, and actually is working for me. I didn't think it would work for me. I thought there's, you know, something wrong with me, it won't work. It is what it is working, actually. So we're like the golfer that's just talking to its caddy. All of us, I've talked to my caddy for, you know, my whole life. And I had the shot, you know, I really had the shot. I understood the shot, you know, I just couldn't swing the club. So the ball's not going anywhere. But, you know, recently I have been, you know, swinging, hitting the ball, and a little chipping. Maybe I was chipping before, chipping. Now I'm taking the driver out and really belting it down the fairway. So, you know, what can anyone do? I know in A Course in Miracles, Jesus said, look, this theory, there's the text and there's the workbook and the handbook for students. And Jesus says, you know what? The text is great. It gives you the theory. It explains it to you, and you like to read about explanation. That's great. He said, but you, the lessons, the practice lessons, are where it's really at. And you have to actually do the practice, the lessons. Otherwise, you're not going to succeed. You're not going to get it. Pointing to the fact that practice is what actually accomplishes, reaches. It's actually hitting the golf ball and getting the ball. You're not going to get the ball to the green, you know, without swinging the club. It's not going to happen. But no matter what anybody says, most people will not practice, for sure. They will not. And I think, well, didn't Buddha have some kind of assistant that was very close to them his whole life? I can't remember his name. Ananda or something. That apparently didn't get enlightened. Because Ananda was like serving Buddha in all these ways and helping him travel and do all this stuff, but maybe he wouldn't practice. He was just intellectual, you know, just, whereas there's many came to Buddha and listened and said, okay, I'm gonna do this practice. I'm gonna start practicing. And, you know, bodhisattvas right there. Arhats or whatever you want to call them, they got enlightened. Once you start practicing, you join the club. You're in the club, actually. You're in the club because you swing the club and you know how to hit the ball. You know how to move the ball down the fairway. It's a whole different level, actually, an entirely different level, where you actually start feeling something like God. You start getting a sense of God, actually. You're tuning into God. It's like you're tuning into God, actually tuning in, and instead of just talking about tuning in. You can talk about tuning in forever, but it's not actually tuning in. Now, nothing overwhelming has happened at all. See, now what I have said is there's a reason for this. I've tried to discover what is the reason here in the world for the resistance. And from what I have seen, it's the continuity problem. For sure, it's the continuity problem. Keeps everybody here from practicing. They just won't do it. They're too afraid. They're too afraid. So first, I think everyone has to look at the continuity problem and try to get a sense of why we have a problem. That's the theory. And then once you really see, recognize and understand why it's there and how do we get in this pickle we're in, the bind we're in, and all this stuff, then the fear of being catapulted back into reality vanishes. You say, it's not going to happen. I trust it's not going to happen. Your trust level increases until the point where then you can start practicing. And then you realize, no, nothing, nothing scary happens. But you do start getting traction, for sure. But nothing scary happens, not at all. I haven't experienced anything scary. I've experienced something like, wow, I could sort of feel that something amazing is very near, and the dawn is coming. But it's not a scary thing. I just say, wow, let me stick with this. This is going to be a really incredible dawn that's going to happen. All from these simple affirmations. This stuff is shorthand. This is shorthand. Okay, it's spiritual shorthand, but it's more than that. It somehow uses your will. Your will is being utilized, and you're setting things right. You're putting yourself back in the right relationship with God and the right relationship with the mind. The location, as you're driving along, you can say, you can even drop the V, and sometimes when you practice, you find, like, cars, let's say cars. Location of car spaciousness doesn't matter. Now, you can be speaking either about one car or all cars. So if you say the location of this car spaciousness doesn't matter, that might, you might be pointing out a particular car. So the location of this car spaciousness doesn't matter. This car spaciousness as it is now. And then you can also generalize, which I found to be very powerful, and say location of car spaciousness doesn't matter. Location of car spaciousness doesn't matter. You could be talking about a car here. You could be talking about all the traffic you're seeing. You could be talking about all the cars in the world. Location of car spaciousness doesn't matter. Car spaciousness as it is now. I see that just packed a very strong resonance right there. So you can say this human body spaciousness, the location of this human body spaciousness doesn't matter. The location of this human body consciousness doesn't matter. Now, I use the term this, and I found that's important rather than that, because where are we actually experiencing everything that we're seeing? Actually, it's right here in the sensory consciousness of the brain, right? We're not actually experiencing it out there. When you use that, you're distancing yourself. So that mountain over there, actually, that mountain over there is actually being perceived right here. Okay, so it's better to say this. So you don't distance yourself and separate and create this sort of dichotomy, dualistic dichotomy. Say, this mountain, or this, the location of this human body spaciousness doesn't matter. This human body spaciousness, as it is now. So I did that. I saw people walking across a crosswalk. I said, I'm just driving. See, walking across a crosswalk. I say, the location of this human body consciousness doesn't matter. This human body consciousness, as it is now. And I felt like, wow, this is a different way to relate to human body spaciousness, isn't it? And again, use the term spaciousness for everything that you're talking about, because that puts it in the right context. Otherwise, you think you're talking about things. You're not. You're talking about thing spaciousness. Then you can say the location of human body consciousness doesn't matter. Spaciousness, I said consciousness. Location of human body spaciousness doesn't matter. Location of human body spaciousness. Location of human body spaciousness doesn't matter. Location of human body spaciousness doesn't matter. Human body spaciousness as it, without any need for modification whatsoever, as it is, this instant, this very instant, doesn't matter, no qualifiers whatsoever, as it is, where it is, as it is, exactly right now, is now, as it is. So, this talking about everyone on the planet, location of human body spaciousness doesn't matter. Human body spaciousness, as it is now. Location of world spaciousness doesn't matter. World spaciousness, as it is now. And you know, we're talking about all the worlds in the whole universe, all the planets in the whole universe. You can talk about it directly. Location of world spaciousness doesn't matter. World spaciousness as it is now. And then you can talk about this world. Look, the location of this world spaciousness, meaning this planet, the location of this world spaciousness doesn't matter. This world spaciousness as it is now. So that's specific. So you have both specific and general. And I try to keep it in the sort of in the singular context. Like, let's say you're going along and see all these trees on the side of the road. I said, the location of this of tree spaciousness, the location of tree spaciousness, or this tree spaciousness, can be either singular or plural. Now, there's a group, a whole bunch of pine trees going along the freeway, and you see all these row of trees. You say the location of this tree spaciousness, meaning this that you're seeing, this tree spaciousness, doesn't matter. This tree spaciousness as it is now. The location of this concrete wall doesn't matter. This concrete wall as it is now. The location of this asphalt street, the location of this asphalt spaciousness doesn't matter. This asphalt spaciousness as it is now. And then also I found, use just this, the location of this spaciousness. Let's say you're looking out and there's buildings and streets and people, and it's a whole scene, a mise en scene, you know. So you say, the location of this spaciousness doesn't matter. This spaciousness as it is now. So it's kind of like composing a tune. There's very few chords in there, and then you do progression on the chords and stuff. You can do singular, you do plural. This tree spaciousness, the location of this tree spaciousness doesn't matter. This tree spaciousness as it is now. You can say location of tree spaciousness doesn't matter, which is can include the all trees. Location of tree spaciousness doesn't matter. Tree spaciousness as it is now. You're referring to all the trees on the planet. All the trees in the universe, actually. Because it's absolutely true. Location doesn't matter in the slightest bit. I saw it this morning. How does location matter to everywhereness? Is something closer to it and something farther away? Then why does in relation to the ground of being, location is irrelevant, totally irrelevant. You can also say the location of this tree spaciousness has no value. This tree spaciousness as it is now. You can say has no value, but I find, you know, it depends on what you find better. I found doesn't matter is actually a little more powerful, carries a more powerful punch, a little smoother. Doesn't matter. Absolutely doesn't matter. It does not matter where anything is located. And for the fact that they are, that this everything is abiding in, within the everywhereness, is one with the everywhereness, is one with the every, it's not even abiding in it, is one with the everywhereness. It doesn't matter what the location is. Makes no difference. Doesn't matter at all. So this is what you're saying. You're taking yourself out of this spatial false perspective on location and space. It's an incredible technique. Don't try to figure out how it works or look for success or anything. Just do it, because you can feel this is right. I'm just doing it because I know it's right. Let the results take care of themselves. Now, also what I found today is that another powerful technique is when the mind starts to wander, as it most certainly will. I'm tired. It's a good effort. You know, I did a lot of practice. Now I want to go back to, you know, something. You say, is this practice? Is that practice? What your mind thoughts come out. Is that practice? No, it's not practice. It's got no value then. It's not practice. Get back to practice. I'm getting back to practice. Is that practice? If it's not practice, it has no value. That's what I was doing. So the thoughts would start trying to crystallize around some storyline or something. And I would say, hey, wait a minute. Is that practice? That's not practice. That's not practice. Let's get back to practice. That's not practice. I'm getting back to practice. Because only practice actually works. Only practice actually works. So only practice has value. The vision of oneness is the only value there is in terms of an actual value for us, because it reminds us of reality. But of course, practicing is part of that. You could say practicing is part of the vision of oneness. So it has value. But anything else doesn't really have value, because it doesn't work. It doesn't work. So I found myself like starting to sing a song, and I say, whoa, that's not practicing. That's practicing singing. That's not practicing these declarations. That's not the practice that has value. That practice of singing has no value, and it stopped it. Also find myself like being like a comedian or funny, you know, making impressions, talking, you know, funny. I say, whoa, that's not practice. That's not the practice we're doing. That's not practicing. And stopped it right like that. That's not practicing. So you can practice being very strict about that, and just notice what comes up. So, oh yeah, that's great. I have a really good idea of what you're going to do when you're all enlightened. So I say, whoa, is that practicing? That's not practicing. And get back to practicing. Say, yeah, I'm really practicing great. I say, well, is that practicing? Saying how great I'm practicing? No, it's not. It's not. It's like a piano player played a song or played some chords, says, stops and says, wow, that was pretty cool. I really kind of enjoyed that and stuff. And I said, why are you stopping practicing? That's not practicing. Get back to practicing. So it's amazing how the mind, how slick the mind is. Now the cat has shown up. Cat, do you have to show up at this time? Really? It's amazing how slick the mind is to try and wiggle out of practicing. Really, it tries to do it so many ways, and you just have to say, that's not practicing. Oh, but I'm practicing being funny. That's not practicing. That's avoiding practicing. Don't argue with it. Say, that's not practicing. And then get back to practicing. And you'll find it, wow, you got to like snap out of like, you're starting to fall asleep. Well, it's like you're falling asleep. You're practicing and it's going great. And then the mind starts, you know, thinking about something else. And before you know it, you've completely forgotten, you know, what you were doing. And you say, wait, is that practicing? That's not practicing. Oh yeah, okay. This is now. That's sign of yourself. This is now. This is now. Wherever you are, you can say this, meaning your surroundings. Everything, including everything you're surrounding, is just the whole situation you're in, the totality. This is now. Say, this is now. And that starts waking you back up again. This is now. The location of this spaciousness doesn't matter. This spaciousness, as it is now. As it is now. This spaciousness, as it is now. This is now. This is now. This is now. Sometimes I use this phrase. This is like the root phrase of this practice. This is now. You can use it after you make a specific declaration. Like, this building spaciousness. The location of this building spaciousness doesn't matter. The location of this building spaciousness doesn't matter. This building spaciousness as it is now. This building spaciousness is now. This building spaciousness is now. This building spaciousness is now. This is now. This is now. This is now. So you can kind of build up your own little powerful declaration in this way. You can start out by saying, this is now. This is now. This spaciousness is now. This spaciousness is now. This building spaciousness is now. This building spaciousness is now. The location of this building spaciousness doesn't matter. This building spaciousness as it is now. This building spaciousness is now. This spaciousness is now. So you see how you can just compose this little, you know, you can do it that way to add emphasis to it. So when you're trying this out, you just try it out and see how you can smooth it out for yourself. And just keep trying. And of course the mind will drift off for sure. And snap out of it. It's like going back into a coma. Being called back into a coma. And just say, ah, that's not practicing. Whoa, that's not practicing. This is now. This is now. This is now. This is now. Which is true. This is now. And the understanding is not an intellectual understanding. It's a spiritual, intuitive understanding. It's like you're speaking the language of spirit is what's happening. Not the language of the intellect. The intellect says, aha, I don't understand this. Fine. Right. Don't explain it to the intellect because it will never understand it. But spirit understands this talk, this language. Absolutely it does. It says, oh, now finally, I'm waking up. Now I'm waking up. I'm waking up. Oh, this sounds very familiar, very familiar. I understand what's being said here. Of course, of course, of course. The location of this mountain spaciousness doesn't matter. This mountain spaciousness as it is now. Yeah, it doesn't. It's not. Its location has no relevance to the fact that as it is now. Totally irrelevant. Totally irrelevant. Totally doesn't matter. The location of this mountain spaciousness does not matter. This mountain spaciousness as it is now. And so I found this to be, I began feeling very, a different feeling towards everything. Different feeling. It had not been there before. It's you know, what kind of word do you use for it? You have to feel it. Sort of a recognition, some sort of deep acknowledgement of something. It's like, so words, you know, if you don't have any, if you're trying to talk about some feeling that you don't have other than using practicing like this, then it's useless for those who have not practiced. They don't understand what you're talking about, really. You just have to experience it. People say, well, you feel a oneness, you feel a compassion, you feel you're in the heart, this kind of thing. forget those terms. Forget it. Is that practicing? You say, hey, is that practicing? You know, talk about, well, we call it the heart, we call it the, you know, love. Forget it. That's not practicing. That's not practicing. The only way you'll experience it is if you practice. And the ego will say, oh, no, I can have an experience of it. Well, not exactly. You can spend your whole life and you hope to have one mystical experience. Maybe you can arrange it. You're real tired. You know, somehow you get a breakthrough or something. It's not the same. It's not really the same. It may be something fleeting, but this is different. This is different. You're in control. You're generating it. You realize that what you're doing is aligning you. You understand what's going on. you know that this that you're practicing is bringing this alignment. You are consciously waking up. That's very different than just sort of having a, you know, kind of like a fluke, little mini peak experience or something. Don't go for peak experiences. I never tried to go for those. Like I said, you know what? That's for losers. Don't do that. Take the way where you are able to generate this. You're able to, you know, do it simply by practicing like this. You're able to look at this, plant. And I just driving by and I see this plant. And I say, the location of this plant spaciousness does not matter. This plant spaciousness, as it is now. And I just, you know, just like a laser, I'm just telling this plant. I'm acknowledging this plant, you know, of what its real condition is, right? It's abiding in God. And I'm acknowledging that plant. And you feel like, wow, you know, I just acknowledged that, you know, this spaciousness is just as it is, is abiding in God. And it just, it produces this wow feeling that it cannot be, you know, really explained. But if you like it, you say, this is what I really want. This is what I really want. And you can say it to anything. Like I see a tree, I say, a tree, it said, the location of this tree spaciousness does not matter. This tree spaciousness as it is now. This is now, this is now, this is now. Which gives a sort of even a broader context to it. Widens it out, as it were. And when I said it to that stone, I saw this paver stone, and I said, I feel so sorry for the paver stone. I said, wow, you're just this lump of clay, square block of clay, lying in this huge grid of paver stones, locked in, you know, forever, for, you know, for centuries or whatever, and you're just not moving ever, and you just, that's where you are, and you're just, there's one next to you, another this side, and that's all there is to you, huh? And I said, that's not possible. I said, spoke to the paver stone, directed my attention, and said, the location of this paver stone spaciousness doesn't matter. This paver stone spaciousness, as it is now. Meaning, it's equally abiding in God to everything else in the entire cosmos. Anything else that will ever arise, equally, absolutely equally, is abiding in it. And it's like you feel like you set the paver stone free from delusion, or at least your delusional perception of it, you know, is changing. And you understand what the great teachers have said. They said, whatever comes, you know, into their awareness and in life, whatever events and experience, everything that comes, it's all equal. It's all equally welcome. Totally freed of location. You know, location makes no difference. Time makes no difference. None of this. It's all equally God. It's all God. It's all God. It's all God. And they just sit there in bliss. I mean, they just go about their life. Everything is blissful. And I'm seeing that that's very possible. Seeing how you can practice to actually bring this about. Actually bring it about. Actually align with this. And again, you can expand it. Say, this time, the location of time spaciousness doesn't matter. Time spaciousness as it is now. The location of past spaciousness doesn't matter. Past spaciousness as it is now. The location of future spaciousness doesn't matter. Future spaciousness as it is now. You can do it with thought. The location of thought spaciousness doesn't matter. Thought spaciousness as it is now. And to make it plural, include all thought, just say, location of thought spaciousness doesn't matter. Thought spaciousness as it is now. You can have one thought, the location of this thought spaciousness doesn't matter. This thought spaciousness as it is now. That's singular. And then you can go to the more plural and the general, like all thought. The location of thought spaciousness doesn't matter. Thought spaciousness as it is now. So even if you can't practice this, or you say, I don't understand, you might be able to at least, that there's something ringing a bell somewhere. It's like, hey, this might work. This really might work, actually. There might be a way, you know. There might be a way. I'm seeing there is a way. So you can laud a teacher endlessly, but if you don't practice, you won't get anywhere, just spinning your wheels. But of course, trying to practice and failing is helpful, because, I mean, I've been flunking my whole life, but at least I've been trying. I've been trying to do, I just can't. It's like you're stuck in quicksand or something. It's very difficult. But at least every day, say, I got it today, I just got to, you know, try, you know, as best I can, get my best effort. And eventually, you know, the continuity, fear of the continuity issue gets diminished to such an extent that you can actually start practicing. But I would say you have to work on the continuity issue, clarifying that the continuity problem is the only problem that I have. That's essential. And so that is very important, and so continuing on with that is vitally important. I'm just getting out these exercises here as they occur to me in the morning, so that at least they're on tape here and people realize, hey, you know, the spiritual path really does work. Now, the use of language in this way is very... the neighbors clear out. The use of language in this way is very unusual. We're not used to it. The mind goes, whoa, what are you saying? I don't understand this. It's different use of language, right? This as it is now. This as it is now. The location of this spaciousness doesn't matter. This spaciousness as it is now. This is basically saying truth is true. Reality is reality. God is God. Is basically just saying that, but we're bringing it into the level of perception, okay? And we have to do that in order to resolve the continuity problem. The vision of oneness resolves the continuity problem. The vision of oneness is the only value there is. Smoothed out sameness. So as long as you're thinking location matters, how can you have smoothed out sameness? It's impossible. Impossible. I saw that this morning, I said, holy cow. This is super important practice, like location. Very important, right? Because everything seems to be located somewhere. All location is relative, right? What does location really mean to God? Does God say, where are you located? Not at all. Does zero dimensionality say, where are you located? No. You are equally abiding in the perfect formless everywhereness. Everything is equally. So how could location matter in that context? It doesn't matter at all. And so we're believing location. What's a location? We're obsessed with location. So how do we get out of that, like, terribly deep dream? And this is how. You start just using this technique and stating the facts. And it's like you start waking up. And the mind creeps back. The cat is back. The cat is back. Come on. And then you push the cat away, you know? And you know it's going to come back again, but maybe you can get a little break from it. Right? The cat is just playing its role here in the video by being the antagonist. Or maybe just giving the viewers a break here from this intensity. Hey, it's raining. It's raining in California. A little bit. We can get a little bit more this time. Just enough to tantalize us, basically. Uh-oh. See, the cat made its jump. Uh-oh. Now it's got its claws into my shirt. Get out. Okay. See, the cat has its way. The mind has its way. You have to say, is this practicing? No, it's not. Is this practicing? No, it's not. It's not practice. That is not practice. Now the question is, when you get tired of practicing, what do you do? That's a tough one. You try to minimize your what you're doing to distract yourself. And you notice it, and you try to say, whoa, 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 not so much there, whoa, whoa, not so much there. And we're so habituated to not practicing that we think, oh, I got to take a break or something. So we do, but then we start really drifting off. And so it's important to know, cat, to say, you know, this is now, keep practicing. Your practicing needs to try to be an uninterrupted stream. Of course, this lofty, lofty goal. And most of us will drift off and, you know, start thinking about something that, and it's not practicing. Just ask yourself as you're drifted off, just suddenly say, is this practicing? Oh, no, it's not. This is not practicing, okay. What practice? This is now. This is now. This as it is now. This spaciousness as it is now. This spaciousness as it is now. So I'm being a little more firm with this cat, more than last night where it got up on the, you know, moving around. I'm saying, hey, stay away, stay away, stay away. It's like the mind saying, hey, no, 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 no. Don't stop interfering. You're not going to interfere with my practicing. Motion, driving, you're driving. This driving, the location of this driving doesn't matter. So you're driving along in a car, vehicle, and you're seeing all this stuff. You can say, hey, the location of this driving spaciousness doesn't matter. This driving spaciousness as it is now. Is now, you know, is abiding in the now, is one with the now. Here comes the cat again. It doesn't give up. He says, it's raining, I gotta bother you. I said, no, you can sit there, which is what it's doing now. The location of this driving spaciousness as it is, the location of this driving spaciousness doesn't matter. This driving spaciousness as it is now. So when you get distracted like that, you might jumble it up a little bit. And that's okay. You just go back. Here it comes again. You see, this is now. This is now. This is now. Okay. The location of this driving spaciousness doesn't matter. This driving spaciousness as it is now. So the mind will like play it cool like the cat is right now. And say, oh, I'm not trying to bother you. I'm not going to bother you. I just want to sit here over here. But I guarantee you that it's going to try to leap up here again. Guaranteed. Right? So the mind is just waiting for an opportunity for when you're distracted to jump in. So I'm going to move over here and block the cat like that. And it moved a little bit because it's seen as being blocked. Yeah. So you do have to be proactive with the mind as it tries to distract you, for sure. For sure. And it's a pesky thing, like a pesky fly. The great meditators say they reached a stage of uninterrupted meditation. Well, gotta believe them, because they give evidence of that. And here we are, just, you know, dreadfully struggling of trying to practice a little bit in the great meditators, uninterrupted, totally interrupted, pure spaciousness. This is now. This is now. They're just abiding in this is now. And then you can just say, abiding in now. Not even this is now, just, uh-oh, now it's aiming for the camera. See? So, keep on practicing as the mind tries to be disruptive. In fact, next time I think I'm going to lock the cat in the kitchen because it's being too disruptive out here. right? And maybe that'll be pure, uninterrupted meditation. The location of evening spaciousness doesn't matter. Evening spaciousness as it is now. Location of evening spaciousness doesn't matter. Evening spaciousness as it is now. Location of rain spaciousness doesn't matter. Rain spaciousness as it is now. Rain's, yeah. Nope. That'd be very, relentless. The mind is relentless. The mind is absolutely relentless. It says, hey, you're not giving me what I want. Location of evening rain spaciousness doesn't matter. Evening rain spaciousness as it is now. And again, don't extrapolate too far ahead of like, oh, I'm going to feel great when I finish these practices. I'm going to be, and then you're not practicing, you know, not practicing. Nope. Trying to jump up again. Nope. Ow. Very persistent. Just like the mind. Mind doesn't give up trying to distract you. So. Location of time, spaciousness doesn't matter. Time, spaciousness as it is now. Time, spaciousness as it is now. Time, spaciousness is now. This is now. Time spaciousness is now. This spaciousness is now. Finally, the cat finally moved on there. He'll be back. Put up a huge fight there to yeah. All right. The location of dirt spaciousness doesn't matter. This dirt spaciousness, as it is now. And don't leave anything out. You're going towards a vision of oneness. If you're leaving something out, you will not have the vision of oneness. So you have to make sure that you're not making an exception. This stone, you see the stone, and say, hey, you just say, wait, stop, you say, this, turn your attention to the stone and say, the location of this stone spaciousness doesn't matter. You know, you get some stones just lying there by the side of the freeway, right? It's just, you say, oh my God, that poor stone, that's where it is, it's just sitting there and, you know, on the side, in the dirt by the side of the freeway, and say, no, they say, well, wait a minute. The location of this stone spaciousness doesn't matter. This stone spaciousness as it is now. In other words, it's God. Everything is God. There's only one. It's only God. God is all in all. It's all God. It's all pure spaciousness. So, Your eye will catch things. You'll notice things as you're going through the day. Maybe a pen. The pen is in a pen holder, and you see the pen and say, wow, a pen is just this pen sitting in a pen holder. Say, no. No. The location of this pen spaciousness doesn't matter. This pen spaciousness, as it is now. Completely sacred. A book. You see a book sitting up on the shelf. It's been sitting there for 35 years and no one's even opened it. You probably read it back in 1968 or something. And it's been just sitting there ever since. Got all sorts of books in various places, right? You see it like that. It's just sitting there. Never cracked open. And you say, look at the book and say, the location of this book, spaciousness, does not matter. The fact that it's just sitting on this bookshelf and right, books on either side, and it's all closed up and no one's looking. The location of this book spaciousness does not matter. This book spaciousness as it is now. Just hit a very strong resonance there. How many books are just sitting there like that, right? Around the world, just say, location of book spaciousness doesn't matter, all right? Liberate all books. Location of book spaciousness does not matter. Book spaciousness as it is now. Maybe you got all these DVDs on the shelf, all these DVDs you haven't looked at one for 10 years. And you say, the location of this DVD spaciousness does not matter. This DVD spaciousness as it is now. And then liberate all DVDs sitting on some, DVD bookshelf somewhere, DVD shelf, all over the world. Location of DVD spaciousness does not matter. DVD spaciousness as it is now. Some clothes are hanging in the closet, and you haven't worn those clothes since 1975 or 1985 or 95, right? And you just look and just say, oh gosh, it's in the dark, it's just hanging there back in the corner, just dark, and say, this clothing spaciousness, the location, it's in a corner, the location of this clothing spaciousness does not matter. This clothing spaciousness as it is now. We got some shoes again, the back of some closet. The location of this shoe spaciousness doesn't matter. This shoe spaciousness as it is now. Set all things free. We have the power to set everything free, actually. Because really, its imprisonment is only in our own belief system. Nothing is really in prison at all. But to our perception, everything's in prison, actually. You see some old tree on some hill, some old tree, and you just say, tree, the location of this tree spaciousness doesn't matter. This tree spaciousness as it is now. The location of old tree spaciousness doesn't matter. Location of old tree spaciousness doesn't matter. Old tree spaciousness as it is now. Whatever catches your eye, but don't exclude anything, because you're going to, everything is included in this. The location of world spaciousness doesn't matter. World spaciousness as it is now. Includes everything, all worlds and all universe. Location of space spaciousness doesn't matter. Space spaciousness as it is now. Because all the space that we see, that too is just a decoration arising in pure spaciousness. It's also a thingness as we perceive it, but it's actually the same pure spaciousness is actually all there is. But from the standpoint of perception, of course, that cannot be perceived. It can only be known. So we're getting to the resolution of the continuity problem here. It means we retain perception. So we retain words, concepts, etc., and talking about it, practicing, etc. But location of space spaciousness doesn't matter. Space spaciousness as it is now. Location of star spaciousness doesn't matter. Star spaciousness as it is now. So it doesn't matter where this star is, or that star is, or this star, or any star is. The location doesn't matter. It does not matter at all. The location of star spaciousness does not matter. Star spaciousness as it is now. Light, location of light spaciousness does not matter. Light spaciousness as it is now. So all the light we're seeing, energy, the location of energy spaciousness doesn't matter. Energy spaciousness as it is now. Okay, all the energy, okay? And location of energy spaciousness does not matter. Energy spaciousness as it is now. Location of quiet spaciousness does not matter. Quiet spaciousness as it is now. It's not only things that we think of as things, but attributes. Time, motion, resting, space, quiet, you know, whatever. That is all still, we all still conceptualize, we still perceive it, and it has thingness to us. So we need to put in the right context that free ourselves from this delusion. Location of resting spaciousness does not matter. Resting spaciousness as it is now. Location of action spaciousness does not matter. Action spaciousness as it is now. Location of fear spaciousness doesn't matter. Fear spaciousness as it is now. Location of love spaciousness does not matter. Love spaciousness as it is now. Peace, location of peace spaciousness does not matter. Peace spaciousness as it is now. So we're working on this issue of location, location, location. In real estate, location, location, location. In spiritual, in enlightenment, realization, location, location, location. It has to be overcome, has to be diminished, has to get to the point where we see everything as one. And see, it doesn't matter what location. Location is irrelevant, totally irrelevant to oneness, isn't it? And so we have to get ourselves accustomed, our mind accustomed to it, until we can say, okay, that's not a problem at all. That's not going to be a problem. You can say, location of location spaciousness doesn't matter. Location spaciousness, as it is now. Okay, again, location of location spaciousness does not matter. Location spaciousness, as it is now. Location spaciousness is now. That one tended to quiet the mind quite a bit. I have to kind of force myself to talk. The ego doesn't know what to say about that one, really. It just stopped it, you know, full stop, just quiet. Just went quiet. So this is now. This is now. And however you feel, if it doesn't feel like so potent when you say this is now, then try some other, you know, form of practice. It will shift and change. You know what you feel like is really strong for any particular moment. Go back to something a longer format. This spaciousness, the location of this spaciousness, the location of this dark, that's dark outside, the location of darkness spaciousness doesn't matter. Darkness spaciousness as it is now. Location of darkness spaciousness does not matter. Darkness spaciousness as it is now. Lightness, location of lightness spaciousness, of light spaciousness, let's say. Location of light spaciousness doesn't matter. Light spaciousness as it is now. So the ego will say, well, how did you make progress? I don't understand what you did. Okay, can you explain it to me? I mean, where's the progress? Well, you know what? I don't get it. Well, when you start feeling this feeling of the mind suddenly just like, well, being knocked out, you know, and just not really being able to say anything, and you start feeling this wow factor of there's something that's getting it, I'm getting it. Why? We don't need to explain anything to the ego. Don't need to explain anything to it. Just keep practicing. It's like breathing. The ego says, well, what is this breathing thing? Can you explain to me, you know, what's going on and give me a detailed explanation of breathing? What is this breathing thing? Obviously, when you're breathing, you're oxygenating, you know, the whole system. And the ego doesn't understand, what is this, what are you doing, why do you like breathing? I don't understand why you like breathing. Can you explain to me why you like breathing? And do you stop breathing to explain? Now you keep breathing. Don't even pay attention. Like, it's just a stupid, you know, you got some kind of whimsicality is just flitting around. Let's get back to practice. Location of whimsicality, spaciousness doesn't matter. Whimsicality, spaciousness as it is now. Location of whimsicality, spaciousness doesn't matter. Whimsicality, spaciousness as it is now. Ego has not come up with a response for that at all. It's just kind of in shock. Now, I can only do these videos because during the day I'm practicing all day long as I'm driving and working and going, doing everything. So I have some really intense practicing there. When you're doing a video, you know, you sort of interrupt your reaction to continue talking, continue putting out the practice and showing examples, etc. So I could just sit here quietly for 10 minutes or whatever. I don't know, just don't say anything. But I'm able to just say, no, let's you know, continue on giving you the gist of this. It's okay. Location of whimsical spaciousness does not matter. Whimsical spaciousness as it is now. Yeah, now that's a head scratcher. I mean, that's powerful. We don't even know how to respond to that, do we? We don't even know how to respond to that statement, which is fine. Don't wait for a response. Don't even pay attention. It's not needed. So spirit gets it perfectly well. It says, ah, that's a powerful one. That generalizes, that covers, you know, it really covers it, right? So no need to respond. It's effective. That's it. It's effective. End of explanation. The ego says, well, how is it effective? It doesn't matter. It's effective. It's effective. It's effective because it's aiming toward what I really want. Absolutely. Vision of oneness. So it's effective. Location of whimsical spaciousness does not matter. Location of whimsical spaciousness does not matter. Whimsical spaciousness as it is now. Location of non-whimsical spaciousness does not matter. Non-whimsical spaciousness as it is now. Location of non-whimsical spaciousness does not matter. Non-whimsical spaciousness as it is now. That one's even stronger, you know. Why? The ego's just, you know, stunned, I would say, or something. I don't know. It doesn't matter. In other words, the ego reactions don't matter. Don't really matter. It'll get around to bugging you again at some point. Don't worry about that. It'll come up with some stupid way to bug you. So don't even think about it. Don't even think about how is it going to bug me after this. No, forget it. It's not important. It's not practice, is it? But spirit is like waking up, feeling resonating. Like, wow, that's great. I didn't realize I could say that. I didn't realize I could think that. I didn't realize I could focus on that. I didn't realize that was possible. And people say, some people say, hey, what's wrong with you? Are you on drugs or something? Or, you know, why are you saying this stuff? Nobody on drugs could say this kind of stuff. No way. People on drugs just are rambling. Their thoughts are, you know, they're disconnected. And they think they're being profound. They're not. If you listen, they're not being profound at all. Hey man, you know, it's like, yeah, it's just like really, I'm just like kind of feeling this way, and sometimes, and it goes on and on and on and on. Nothing profound. There's no profound practice right there. So this is the opposite of being on drugs, is the capacity to do this. Remain very clear, very adamant, very focused, very centered, ability to be quiet, to stop. Any agitation, without any confusion, you know, totally in control of the whole situation, really. But being on the edge, because you're just making progress, and you're getting this wow, these wow pops of like this wow, wow. But you got, you know what the practice is, so you say, okay, let's continue on. Location, location, location. Location of civilization spaciousness doesn't matter. Civilization spaciousness as it is now. Civilization spaciousness as it is now. This spaciousness as it is now. This spaciousness as it is now. This world spaciousness as it is now. This civilization spaciousness, as it is now. Location of civilization spaciousness doesn't matter. This civilization spaciousness, as it is now. Location of life spaciousness doesn't matter. Life spaciousness, as it is now. Location of person spaciousness doesn't matter. Person spaciousness as it is now. So what are we doing here? We're blessing the whole world in our consciousness, in our perception. We're blessing every person in the world. We're acknowledging their total sacredness and their total liberation from delusion. Everyone, location of person spaciousness doesn't matter. Person spaciousness as it is now. People wondering, whoa, what did he eat? What did he eat? What's he on? What'd you eat? Peanut butter sandwich with some honey and a banana puree smoothie, a little bit of banana smoothie, which is totally unusual. Oh, that must be it. No, because I've been practicing all day and I had oatmeal for breakfast. Oh, the oatmeal is it. I want to eat oatmeal. Well, that's not a bad thing for breakfast. Doesn't matter. Hey, location of food spaciousness doesn't matter. Food spaciousness as it is now. Location of food spaciousness doesn't matter. Food spaciousness as it is now. Food spaciousness as it is now. Food spaciousness is now. Food spaciousness is now. Food spaciousness is now. So this is hitting me, you know, real hard, real good. I want to keep on going, but I got to keep the video at some you know, reasonable length. I can go 2 hours with this YouTube editing format, but you know, just I could keep on going and going and going and going. May need to do that at some point, coming up in the world. May need to do that, actually. Things, situations could get so out of hand very quickly in this world that may need to be broadcasting live, you know, doing this technique until people can join in and just start doing it. Because I think people may start doing it soon just because they realize that they can't procrastinate any longer. The jig is up. Jig is up here in this world. Definitely. They say, okay, I'm just going to do it. What the heck? I'm going to do it. I mean, that's how I feel. I know the jig is up, so procrastination is over. I gotta get this. I gotta get this nailed. You know, I gotta do it. Gotta do it. You gotta swing the club. You gotta hit the ball. You gotta play 18 holes. You gotta finish the course. You know, you gotta finish. You gotta finish. Now, if I was like a totally liberated, perfect guru, I would be taking notice of myself as doing this practicing. I would say someone is practicing there. There's awareness of it, for sure. Because it doesn't happen that often. It hasn't happened that often. It doesn't happen very often that someone actually gets down to it and practices. So of course, you would take notice. Say, this is auspicious. Absolutely. Playing the game, y'all. Not talking to the caddy, playing the game. That's a whole different thing. Whole different situation, as it were. So, absolutely, I expect what's being done here is being noticed at the level of pure clarity. Has to be. Absolutely has to be. No doubt about it. Couldn't possibly be overlooked, because this is potent medicine we're giving out here. And we need it. This is the right medicine for the right time. Very potent medicine, because the problems of the world, you're going to need a very potent medicine. And you're just going to have to say, I'm practicing. You know, forget about everything. The world's going to pieces, saying, location of world crisis spaciousness doesn't matter. World crisis spaciousness as it is now. All right? Location of world crisis spaciousness doesn't matter. World crisis spaciousness as it is now. That's a showstopper right there. Whew. I gotta break the silence, you know, in order to continue this video. But you get the sense that it's important. It's important to give the right medicine at the right time. So those of you who are considering this, you're ahead of the game. And hopefully, at the right point, you'll stop your procrastination. If you have a sense like, you know what, I'm one of those who's going to get it done, then you know at some point you'll stop your procrastination. Say, okay, that's it. I'm getting down to it right now. That's it. Location of procrastination spaciousness doesn't matter. Procrastination spaciousness as it is now. right medicine at the right time. That's it.